DPR, DMRC have been appointed as consultants for by PMC, Delhi Metro Corporation, and they submitted their DPR in June 2009. So after the DPR came in the public domain, we have studied it and other citizen groups have also studied it. And a lot of issues came up out of that, which were informed to corporation as well as state government. But they have not taken any cognizance of that, and that DPR was approved by the PMC General Body in January 2010. In a single sitting, meaning it was presented sometime in the, I think, maybe afternoon, and by evening it was approved. And it was quite surprising, you would be surprised to know that the resolution for approval of DPR did not have the DPR with it. So it was only a paper which was presented to the corporators, and they were just told that this is a very good DPR, you have to approve it, we have to immediately send it to the state government, then to the central government. And so that in the budget of February, that is February 2010, we will get the allotment, and so the metro can start in 2010.
Pune? You are talking about Pune?
Yes, yes, Pune.
So, except one corporator, all other corporators supported that resolution, and they had not even seen what the DPR's front page is or the cover page is. So that's why we say that the DPR was approved blindly. It was a blind approval, meaning the PMC themselves also did not study it open and read it also. That is what we feel, because the sort of things that have appeared in the DPR clearly shows that nobody has even read it. So at that time, we had run a campaign in 2010, 2011, 2012, and we had, this is of course an updated presentation, not to get made presentations to several people, several places, telling them what are the issues. But there was no response, and now you are aware that the particular DPR is with the central government for final approval. So we had made this presentation at the time for citizens that you should know it, because we were telling corporation that this DPR is worth about 454 or something like pages in English and totally technical. So we, when we insisted, they just put the DPR on their website. So now they say it is on the public domain, so we are shared with the public. So we, whoever wants can see the DPR, and then they can come to their own conclusions. But we were telling them how such a technical DPR of 450 odd pages, a common citizen, layman citizen, can download it, read it, understand it, and then come to certain conclusion of his own, whether what this is being offered is really will be useful to me or not. So we were telling them that make an overview of it in Marathi, English, every all languages, two, three languages, at least two languages, English, Marathi, and then you put it and even make a booklet out of it and let people know what are the salient features of this, but they never agreed to that. So that's why we made this, it was quite a large presentation, but I have condensed it. So we said, we made this presentation for citizens and you should know about it. That's why, and I have called myself as a worried citizen. So as a worried citizen, because I have studied it and I am greatly worried by what is there in that proposal. So I am studying, you should know it. So that is how actually the name has come out. So one of the issues that came up was, we are always, myself, Sujit, everyone are always promoting public transport. So metro is a public transport. So the question that was asked was, why are you opposing metro when it is a public transport? So we were saying that yes, we need a good public transport. So this was the statement we had given. But there are various public transport options are available. Normal bus service, BRT, tram, monorail, LRT, metro. This is the hierarchy actually. So it goes, it's a ladder. So first you should have a good bus service. So city bus service is the backbone of any public transport system and should get top priority. However, you know what the situation of PMNE is today. So that has been totally, it is in the dumps, it has been left in the lurch, and suddenly you are taking the last step. Then you have jumped so many steps and come to the metro. So actually, one seat, even the bus service may not be enough, but then we will need a multimodal transport, as it is called. So we have to decide what modes we want out of this. like Anita was saying, we should go for tram, also first with bus, BRT, tram. And that way we go, because there will be the cost also is in that, increases in that fashion. So a multimodal transport system which should give proper connectivity and interchange facility is what is required. And then whatever transport or combination of systems we choose should be need-based. So as you were asking someone just now, that whether metro is needed. So need-based, it should be efficient, also affordable is also important, because if public transport is to be used by common citizens, it should be affordable, people-friendly, and it should fit into the fabric of the city. So that is also important. You cannot bring in any system and just dump it on the city. So it has to fit into the fabric of the city. So that we said is the basic criterion, whether this metro has... So what is metro as compared to that? So metro is the most expensive. So the... Yeah, basically you can ask one or two questions, but a discussion would distract.
On that side, what is the percentage of population in Pune which is using the transport which is bus, and what is the rest which is on two wheels?
See, roughly now it is a 10 lakh is said to be the roughly ridership of.
It has slid from 12 and a half lakhs.
It was 13 lakh, now it has slipped to 10 lakhs. So roughly it is 10 lakhs is the ridership in Pune of the bus service. So it is actually the ticket. So actual ridership will be less than that, because some may be having a return trip and all that. So
70%.
Yeah, so maybe about 7-8 lakhs. So if you can say about it, could come to maybe how much? If 35 lakhs is Pune's population, it could be about 20% roughly say.
Yeah.
If 7 lakhs is the people who are traveling daily, so it is 20%, you can say. City buses. So actually somebody was asking about the cost. So roughly the cost is 250 crores per kilometer for elevated metro, and underground would be 300 to 400 crores per this thing. So this is minimum cost, 250 crores.
So underground is about 50% more?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, roughly 50% you can say, because so, and then metro operation, metro train capacity is also 1000 to 1500. So, when the capacity increases, the flexibility decreases. Because you need to have a certain minimum number of passengers to travel. Otherwise, it will be running in tremendous loss. Meaning we don't expect public transport to run in profit. But maybe somewhere it has to be close to the operational expenses. It cannot be a 1500 passenger coach is running with only 100 passengers. So, that will be a very disastrous thing for the financial point of view. And most important part about metro is that when we talk about metro, it is irreversible and permanent. Like when you have a bus service or even tram or something, we can change the routes. Today it is not viable, we can say, okay, we scrap it, put it somewhere else. That is not possible. This is a constructed corridor. So once you construct it, it is there for the lifetime of the city. So the same logic or same thinking that goes into making bus routes should not go into metro. So we have to be very, very careful about metro. That's one of the most important things. So any wrong decision about metro will prove disastrous for the city. So once you make the metro everything, and then you find it is of no use. So you have spent 10,000 crore rupees and you have damaged the whole city fabric, and then you find that nobody is using the metro. Like we see in the pedestrian subways or foot or bridges, same thing is happening. They are spending crores of rupees, nobody is using. Same thing, imagine if it happens to a metro. What would be the sort of situation? And now why Pune Metro is, we are not opposed to metro. Another thing was told to everyone that these people are anti-development, they are opposing metro. It's not the question of opposing metro at all. Why it has become a matter of serious concern is that all these serious issues, despite these serious issues, the Pune Metro project report has been approved by PMC without any, we said, okay, don't believe us. Appoint some third party experts, let them study it, and then share with us what they have done, and allow us to put our case in front of them or before them. So they said no, there is no need. Why there is no need? Because DMRC are the ultimate, they are the gods of metro. So when a god is telling you something, why you need to question? Literally, so it became like a Bible, and nothing is to be questioned, not a single word out of it. Even if it's a spelling mistake, let it be there. Mm. That sort of an attitude TMC had. So that's why it became a matter of concern. If they had shown transparency and shared all information with us and had a public consultations, taken the views of all into consideration, then probably we would have had a very good metro by now.
How do they do the root rationalization?
Root rationalization?
They don't, do they do that?
No, no. What they have done is, as Amita said, whatever was suggested by those.
I'm asking about root rationalization.
No, there is only one, two roots. Where is the question of rationalization? There is only two roots are there. So there is no. When there are multiple roots, like in PMPM, there are 350 roots, there you can talk of rationalization. There are only two roots. So these are the phase one of the metro, corridor one, corridor two. So all the details are written here, including the cost factor. These costs are based on 2013 prices. So already they must have increased now because we are 1.5 years ahead. So actual cost of execution could be much higher. So total we are having about 31.594 or something like that kilometers, and 10,183 crores is their estimate. So they are expecting a lot of tax waivers and all that is considered. So only central taxes are considered. They are expecting that the state and the corporation taxes will not be applicable. So this is, and corridor 1 is partly elevated and partly underground. So that is also shown up to Shivaji Nagar, it is elevated. And Shivaji Nagar to Swargate, it is underground. So that means they have accepted in principle, or not only in principle, also as a part of the report, that underground metro is required and part of it is being done in the city. So it's not that underground is not involved there. So as a concept or as a principle, they have already accepted. So this is as far as the phase one is concerned. This is phase two, of course. When it will come, we don't know. Phase one only, we don't know when it is coming. But they are shown in the in their DPR. So another metro will be Swargate to Katra, Chinchwad to Nigri, then Deccan, Pura Road, Swargate, Bangadan, Papadishwar, NSP, Inzuri. That is, so phase 1 plus phase 2. Presently the plan is for 75.5 kilometers of metro. It will take 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, we don't know, but the plan is for this much. Phase 1 is being implemented now, phase 2 after that is completed.
Phase 2 is all under
or
elevated or
everything
no,
is elevated.
See, nothing is they mentioned about phase 2, they have just shown the proposed corridors, that's all. So that DPR is all not there, that I just told you what is likely to come in future. So that is only what they have proposed in the DPR, based on their traffic surveys, what they have done. So they say now in phase 1 you do this and phase 2 you do these corridors. So phase 2 is something which nothing has happened. So it is just now only an idea. Put forth. Now what is the PCMC Swargate route? This is the route. So underlined are the stations. So from this route you will understand how the metro is going to travel from PCMC up to Swargate.
But this is not the route they are doing first. They are doing the other route.
No, no. Now there is no first, second. Now both are approved. Both are approved now. So what they are going to do will come up only when they tell us the implementation plan. Earlier case was that corridor 2 had not been approved. Corridor 1 had not been approved, yeah, because PCMC had some reservations.
Oh,
now both are approved. So there is no issue. Actually, we will see in the chronology how it has happened. So this is actually what is happening. So you can see there are two river crossings coming in that route. And the metro is passing through the agriculture college. That is one very very surprising thing. It is
not
passing through the agricultural college for about 1 kilometers. It is going to pass through the campus of the college. So that is what has been proposed. Meaning how it can be done, we don't know. So there are 15 stations and 1 to 9 elevated and 10 to 15 underground.
Is underground cost more than the
elevated?
Yeah,
it will have 50% and 70% See, it depends on
the actual cost. The thing is
that they have not done an analysis for this underground here except for the one they have done. So unless they do a survey and a technical listing, so we have what thumb rule figures. So only thumb rule figures we are talking of. Actual cost will come up only if they do a technical study. So this is the Manaj Ramwadi route that is passing fully through Pune. The earlier one was partly in Pimpri Chinchwad and partly in Pune. This is fully in Pune. So this is the route, and you can see from the route that it is passing from Port Road, Port Vata, Karve Road, Jain Road, then Barve Chowk, Sanpe Chowk, Ambedkar Road. Again, there is a river crossing. Then a full railway station crossing is there. then it will come out in Jahangir Hospital, then Nagar Road, Gerwada, Kalyanagar, Ramgarh. So we can see that it is passing through the prime arterial roads of the city. Maximum traffic, maximum congestion, maximum use by the citizens are very critical for the mobility of citizens. So that is the entire corridor. So that is how it is going to pass. So that's a significant point, that it is passing through fully developed areas and highly congested prime arterial roads, and those roads are also of inadequate width. All those roads except Nagar Road are less than 30 meters. So that they could be even 24 meters. At Port Fata, the road width is hardly 13 to 14 meters. So that is how the thing is that. I mean, they are not, this map I think Anita has already shown.
You can do the, this is better.
So this is how the phase 1 metro is going. Phase 1 from PCMC to Swargate. And this is phase 2 is going from Vanaj to Ramgarh. So this is also, actually it is, they are saying it is a north-south and east-west corridor. So that is how they are just meaning, if you see at it, it looks like just a cross, how it has been done.
You can't cross over from one to the other.
Yeah, that is because one is elevated, one is underground. So that is happening at
junction.
That junction is at Parve Chowk. Very process is at Parve Chowk. And at Parve Chowk, this Vanaj Ramgarh will be going overhead and this will be going underground. So even though you are crossing at one point, you cannot go from one to the other. So this is a very funny situation. Normally it never happens. When you are crossing, you should be able to, direct accessibility has to be there. It's not there. And then these are the phase 2 corridors. This is going to Hinjewadi. Then this is Swargate to Deccan Gym and One Garden. And this is Swargate to Khatra. So these are the phase 2 corridors that are proposed. They are just shown here. This has been prepared by this VIT college, VIT Architecture College. So what are the issues? Basically we need to understand why we are opposing elevated metro. So basically the project is to be implemented through densely populated areas along highly congested arterial roads. So these are all the roads. And what are the features of the metro? So first is the metro columns come on the road. At the road center you will have the metro columns. The height of the column would be 10 meters. The further will be above. This is the bottom of the
station.
Then the column. Above that will come the rails and all the other structure. So there will be a, so it will be like a flyover-like situation. Meaning it will be like a flyover-like structure starting right from Old Road Vanaj up to Ramgarh. So you can imagine visually a continuous flyover going over a distance of about 15 kilometers from Vanaj to Ramgarh along these roads. So that will put the it in a proper perspective.
Continuous flyover which you can't pass. You have to pass under the flyover.
Yeah, yeah. So that is only being visual. So visually imagine how it will look. So the reduction in, now because the columns are at the center, there will be a reduction in carriage weight. The column width is roughly about 2 meters or 1.8 to 2 meters. So there will be some clearances on both sides. So about 3 meters the carriage weight will reduce of the road because of the column. Second is the metro alignment. So you see that when the metro is going, if there are sharp turns or obstructions, then the metro cannot pass. It has to deviate.
It needs a 100 meter radius.
So it needs the radius because it is a train. So it cannot turn like a bus. So it has to have a curvature and a proper radius. So it will deviate from road center where obstructions sharp turns on the road which metro cannot take. For example, Port Fata, there will be an issue. Deccan corner, there will be an issue. Like Andhiji Bapad, so that Lucky Pool, it cannot turn. So they are planning to cut it across at the near the Mumbai Garhwale school. So it will go on top of that school. So third is metro station on road. So actually the station 30 meters, but actually what we're drawing we are having from the gate is 35 meters, then including the staircase and everything whatever comes. So 35 meter wide, 140 meter long, because it needs a platform because it's a train. So the length of the station is 140 meter long and 23 meter high. So it comes to about 7 to 8 story building. So this is a massive structure, and these structures are going to come at the locations what we saw in the earlier route, for example Nalstock or Deccan Corner, or these are the places where these massive structures are supposed to be built. So I don't know anyone anyone, if anyone from TMC or DMRC or whoever has applied their mind as physically coming and standing at the spot and seeing, because that clearly proves that nobody has visited all these spots. They may have probably just done a Google map, that is what we say. So, road widths are inadequate and there is no parking space available. Sujit will object to that, but parking space is, why it is required, we will come to that later. But for two wheelers at least, not cars. Cars I would not expect any parking space. But this is not there. So road width is inadequate. Now if the road is 24 meters, how do you build a 35 meter wide station? So naturally you have to demolish the buildings at the roadside. So actually demolishing is this is very important, violation of fire safety norms. So these fire safety norms have been violated at every elevated metro. So we are saying that heritage, everything, okay, that is already they are not giving any importance, but at least to life and property they are not giving, because what is going to happen when you demolish the buildings, they are not going to keep the side margins whatever are required from the metro station. So we have the photographs afterwards where you will see that the metro station is almost at a handshake distance from the balcony of the residential buildings. No, but that has not been done. I don't know whether they have been demolishing or not. Right now they are existing. Yes, 10 meter is, I don't know, because 10 meter is something which has come up as we saw. No, but that is only in Pune.
Yeah.
So I don't think, because Mumbai and all, there are buildings. Delhi, you see, Bangalore. The buildings are there. That rule is not there, 10 meters. So 10 meter rule is a different issue. But basically, what is happening is, with this particular situation, there is likely to be a violation of fire safety norms and DC rules. And so, basic the impact is that there will be, in case there is an emergency, you cannot access the building. So, fire engine or an ambulance and all will not be able to access all the floors of the building. Then shifting of surface and underground utilities. There are a lot of underground utilities, and in Pune we don't even have a map of which utilities where. So there could be cables, there could be water pipelines, drainage pipelines, stormwater drains, n number of things, telephone cables, and now internet broadband. All these cables are all underneath. So if you want to shift all those, it is going to be a massive job. And basically coordination between agencies will be a major issue there. So it's not a very, it's a very major job, shifting of utilities. The other important thing is road blockage, traffic management during construction. So what is happening is, when they are going to construct, they will need 9 meters of road space for carrying out that construction. So 9 meter in an 18 meter road, if it is a 3-lane road two-way, it is about 18 meters. So if the 18 meter road, 9 meter gone means half the road gone, or both sides, both ways, half the road is gone. So for example, Karve road will be only 4.5 meters on one side and 4.5 meters on the other side. So there are no suitable roads for traffic diversion, because all these roads what we saw where the metro corridor is passing, there are no alternative divergent roads. You don't have any divergent road for Karve road, you don't have anything for JM road, you don't have anything for Bandhagar, nothing. So the traffic, entire traffic, the roads are falling short today itself, but the entire traffic has to pass on those roads and with that 9 meter cutoff. So we will have severe traffic bottlenecks and mobility will be seriously affected. Large number of trees will be, hundreds of trees will be cut. For example, Jagni Maharaj Road we are saying, or Mumbai Avenue I think now in the city area, all the trees will get cut because the metro has to be constructed there. And so visual impact is also an issue. So metro track will be like a continuous flyover road with huge metro stations across entire roadway. So visually also it will not be a very pleasant sight. And over and above that, there will be inordinate delays. So these, all these issues are going to create a lot of practical problems, and the metro work can get stuck up somewhere for some reason or the other. There could be also court cases, litigations where the land acquisition is required. So all sorts of there will be delays and then cost escalation. So we will not know that whatever will be their schedule, that can go totally haywire because of the delays. So this is one just photograph, and we have superimposed that how that 9 meter will look and how that metro column will look on that. How is the reduction in road width of 3 meters and 9 meter barricading during construction. So you can see only that much of road will be available on both sides of the Karve road.
Best part of it.
The
rest of it is even worse.
No, I wanted to in fact highlight how it is happening, because if you make it into a more administrator, you may not see that how that guy can be. Because it will be, if you take a null stop, you will not see this lines at all. And in fact, I have taken it on a relatively lesser traffic map, because otherwise it will be relatively. So this is Paul Fata. There is a 100 meter building coming on one side. There is a flyover on the other side. You know that Kumar building is coming up. That is the first 100 meter line building that was sanctioned in the city. And you can see how congested, and through that the metro is going to pass, and 9 meter is going to get blocked. So this is like a throat for the entire area of Port Road, Kothur, Varje, Karvinagar. All traffic passes through here. So if this gets choked, what will happen? You cannot imagine. It will be a horrific situation. So this I just showed how the metro is going to pass here and how much small space is available. The width is as low as 12 meters on this road. This is actually the Khandajibao Chowk. Again, this VIT college has made this graphic, this thing. So how that here, it is the metro is coming here, but it cannot take this turn, this one. It cannot take this turn, so they are going to cut across. So this is how the metro will be cutting and taking the route. This not this white line is not in this blue violet line. That is how the metro corridor is going to go. So all this here in this, all this here, this could be this probably this Vimlavai Garbhari school and all that. This is the Lekhan Jipana post office, and this is the Garbhari subway, and this Chhatrapati Shivaji Sambhaji Maharaj statue is here. So it is going to cut across. Instead of going like this, it is going to.
The Lekhan post office also goes.
Yeah. So all this area is going to get almost, it will get demolished because the metro is going in this direction. So this is a typical metro station. This is not RKR. I mean, aesthetically it has not been, finishing has not been done, but this is a structure. So you can see how massive it is. It shows 35 meter width. It shows the all the heights and dimensions, 7-story high building. Top of it, of course, not the entire thing, and how the whole structure will be looking. This is a cross-sectional view of that metro station. And you can see that this will be just touching in a road width of 25 meters, 26 meters. It will be just going into other properties, and it will be taking more footpaths and side margins and everything. Some other important issues are the two corridor one, the metro, land for metro depots is all in dispute. So metro depot proposed within agriculture college, area required is 11.5 hectares of land within the agriculture college, they are wanting for metro. And metro to run in the premises for length of about 1 kilometer, and it's reported obviously they will not agree to give that land. So far they have said we will not give the land. And corridor 2 is also a problem. Metro depot proposed that old Kachra depot was there on the Port Road. So at that same site, Shiva Srushti, one project has been long back been sanctioned, and the plan is also ready. I think one that Nitin, somebody has already been given the design, that famous some personality design. So all that work is going on for Shiva Srushti on the drawing paper, drawing. Central, I mean, state government has also approved it, and the same location metro depot is also coming. Beyond that, it is hilly and PDP. There is a complete hill behind that. So that issue has not yet been sorted. So if you see, both the corridors is having only one metro depot each, and both the lands are in dispute. So DMRC has just seen where some vacant land is available and just put the depot. Now it is the headache of PMC to find out how they can claim that land or acquire that land. Another important thing is overlapping of transport options. That is very important. We talked about several options. If you see the Pune Mumbai this TCMC to Shivajinagar, that corridor, you will find that there is a local train route parallel to the
metro.
This corridor. Then we have the great separated highway there, which is a very good, meaning very fast, rapid transit corridor. You can go within half an hour or less from Pune to Delhi. So that rapid transit corridor is there. BRT is there. So all these three options are already available on that PCMC Swargate corridor, PCMC Shivajinagar corridor. So this is the fourth one coming up. So already money has been spent, so early, the idea was that was given to them that why don't we add one line to that same Shivajinagar to this thing, Lonavala.
Regular railway line.
Add one railway line that will be at much a fraction of the cost, and the purpose will be served because all the stations are there, everything is there. But they don't want that, they want metro only. So that is,
and
here, if you see, yeah, that's it's coming. And then another thing, if you see the other corridor, that is the second one, Manaj Rambadi, there you'll find that from Powder Road to Rambadi, there is a full BRT corridor. Already sanctioned, they have taken the money, spent the money also. 1100 crore rupees they have already spent BMC on this corridor. Powder Road, one of the corridors, that is
Powder Road. Supposed to be commissioned.
It should have been commissioned long back, they have not done it, they have just made
they are not doing it, they already spent the money, they don't have the money now. Now they don't know where to get the money.
But the auto development department is saying you must make it otherwise return the money. So they are just doing it willy-nilly.
So they are doing it. So that's why I am saying that there is a BRT corridor already on that. Now that BRT corridor also has its issues because that is also at the central lane. So if you are having a central lane BRT plan, you are having central metro columns also at the road center. How the both are going to coexist? Nobody knows.
And why
do we need both? So, and then there is one more this thing, that there is a riverside road. Now there is a problem with that road, but they are, I think the Plaginal has said you can build an elevated road or something like that. That in the riverside you can put it on the top.
No, that's all false information there.
They have said
realignment.
Cannot be made there.
No, but in the blue line you can add elevated and something.
No, only the part which is done.
That
they
have to elevate. And the river cannot be obstructed.
Anyway, that's so one project has been approved there, Shimle to Kharadi. They are having an elevated road which is already sanctioned by the corporation. So okay, it doesn't come because of the NGT, there is one thing, but they already sanctioned it. Corporation knows they have.
Yeah.
So that, what I am making another point that in that corridor which is going to cost thousands of crores of rupees has also been sanctioned along the same metro corridor. And that on that corridor they are planning a monorail. So that corridor is going from Shivani to Kharadi and Kharadi is also very near to Rambadi only. So we are having multiple mass transport options or modes running parallel to the metro corridor, which never happens because then there are two things. You are going to spend a lot on the metro, and second is the metro ridership will be severely affected because if you have another options, people may choose that option. If only metro is the option, they will have to compulsorily use that option. So you are sacrificing or compromising the ridership of metro. So viability also comes in picture because of these overlapping options. Now low ridership, that you'll be surprised that the Metro DMRC report itself says that there is a very low ridership. Now how low? That even if it is said, the PHPTT means there is a technical term, peak hour, in peak hour, how much of, in direction, how much of people travel. So it is PHPTT. So our metro capacity is 25,000 PHPTT. The break-even point, like when you should go for metro, earliest point is 15,000. And they are saying that even in 2031, the ridership is only 10,980. So we are not reaching the break-even point even in 2031. That is the corridor that has been sanctioned. So obviously, and this is from the metro report itself. We are not talking some fictitious figures. We are not taking claim. So there is only, I am quoting from the metro report. So this means that the metro route is not, as Anita said, some students and all have done the survey and decided the route. So this means that the metro route is not suitable or convenient for people in the area. Obviously, their origin destinations are not matching. That's why they will not be using. And bus connectivity is not there. The parking space, why I stressed on was that the bus connectivity is not good. So okay, at least when the bus connectivity is not good, we can go by two-wheeler, park it there and use the metro like they do at railway station. They take their two-wheeler, park it and then go use the local train. So that option is also not there because non stop there is no standing space where you can talk of parking space. And high passenger density areas are not covered. You are talking of this Manaj Rambadi route. Because you see Shivaji Nagar railway station, then Shivaji Nagar SP bus stand, then Pune railway station and Pune railway station bus stand. These are the four high passenger density locations along this metro corridor. But because it is going elevated and in the vicinity of that, but not touching those points, people say like passengers with luggage and all that, they will not walk down to the metro station and then climb up and go. So it has, if it is underground, then obviously immediately you can just go down and catch it.
They just go down to the
yeah, so these high passenger, that's why the ridership is low. So that high passenger density is very surprising. It is passing through, it is passing over the railway station, but the people from the railway station cannot go to that metro. it's a horrific situation. That is the sort of situation. So these areas are totally excluded from this. And due to such reasons, utility of this will be low and expected. And the, another impact will be that expected reduction in traffic on road will not happen. So if the expected reduction in traffic doesn't happen, because the one of the claims of metro is if you build a metro, the traffic will get reduced to half or quarter or something like that. So here, especially the ridership is low, it is definitely not going to happen. Now with the reduced road width, with the metro stations and traffic increasing at the same pace, we will be in a worst of situation. Because the metro is running empty, and I will tell you, even in Bangalore, my son had gone just a couple of weeks back. I specifically asked him to go in the peak hour and travel in the metro. So he has sent photographs that in the peak hour, office hours, 9, 9:30, 10, metro is empty. And on the traffic is full on the road.
Because it's elevated.
It's elevated metro. So you can see the impact. Bangalore Metro latest commission. Metro empty in peak hours and roads congested below.
Why is the
because metro is full?
No. Because the routes, you see, unless you have a route which is useful to you and the actually convenience, it has to be user friendly, people friendly, that
not
stop.
Not just cost.
Cost is not the issue.
No.
Cost is not the issue. Okay. You want to go somewhere and the metro is dropping out somewhere.
I have another question. Then you say if you go 30 meters below, then you can have a good underground.
Maximum
30 meters. So my question is, will it have an impact on the foundations of the same buildings?
We'll come to that metro, that part that is there. Because there will be some other questions on that. We'll come to that.
So I
would request you to just hold on for 5 minutes. That point is covered, meaning elevated versus underground point is there. So another thing is, now this we talk about the highlights of the problems, what are there. Now PMC and the government of Maharashtra have always been saying that Pune needs a metro, and okay, forget everything, all our objections, everything. Just keep that aside. Is PMC and GOM serious? GOM is government Maharashtra about Pune Metro. So this chronology of events shows you whether they are serious. If something they feel is so urgently required, so such an emergency requirement that the PMC general body sanctioned or approved the report in few hours without seeing the report, that was the urgency that was told at the time. It was such an emergency situation. See the chronology. DPR submitted in June 2009. So these are all the steps, and more than 5 years have passed, but approval still not in hand. And many other metros that have come later on have been approved. So this chronology itself shows how lightly this PMC and GM has taken the Pune Metro. So are they really serious about the metro? So because they claim that they are serious and metro is very urgently required. So this chronology shows 2009 to today, till August 2014, what has happened. And they are blaming the central government, which is absolutely rubbish and nonsense. Because till May, the central government, the same party was there. Pune, Mumbai and Delhi, same party was ruling at all the three locations. So now they should not be blaming, because and they have only submitted all the reply to GM only in August 2014. But this is a political rhetoric. It's Chief Minister and all are saying that central government is not giving approval. So what happened for the 5 years before that? When the same
school, the DMRC has done a better job than compared to Pune.
See, for Nagpur, we don't know anything, because Nagpur, I think nobody like us are sitting and discussing.
Nobody is being examined.
Nagpur had a development authority.
But Nagpur, see, we have not studied Nagpur report, but we have not heard, we have not seen any news item where any of them have studied it or some information about it.
So the citizens in Pune are more inquisitive as compared to those in Nagpur.
The citizens of Pune are the most active all over the country. You don't worry about that part. Pune's citizens will be the most active in the entire reservation.
That is all that when the Nagpur metro got through, it is irrespective of whatever you say.
One of the, see, there's a political overtones also, because of you must have read all the information about it. But we don't know. We cannot make any allegation right now. We have not done any study because there are so many members.
The basic question is, DMRC has done at least 8 to 10 to Kochi, Hyderabad, Bangalore, Jaipur, Ahmedabad, and also Pune. So the fact is, whether they have made the same mistakes in all the other 8 to 10 metros,
yes.
Like they only have.
Yes, they have.
See, Mumbai and other, and this 8 to 10 cities, which are supposed to be like Bangalore, Hyderabad,
yeah.
having a higher intelligentsia crowd, have no objection.
No,
they
have
not
objected. As I told you,
Bangalore people
went
to
Pune. The funny part here is Delhi Metro was not planned by the DMRC guys.
See,
they were conservatives from abroad who planned the first phases of Delhi Metro.
Yeah. No, but the metro is already started.
Basically, DMRC, as I told you right now, DMRC are only metro technology experts. This, all the success or failure of the metro depends not on the technology. Technology is proven. What it depends on is whether that metro routes are correctly selected and whether the type of metro has been correctly selected, whether it is giving connectivity, whether there is interchange facility. That is more important. So there, DMRC has no, they don't do any of these studies.
They have the studies for these 10 metros, right?
You understand this, you go to any DMRC report, you will find a long list of their consultants they have appointed to carry out different services. DMRC only knows railways, that is the metro as a technology. That's all. And
so
there also there are
appointed consultants. Correct?
Yeah, that's what Anita said, na, that even in IIT Mumbai was appointed for Pune, and IIT Mumbai offloaded the job to three students.
Postgraduate
students.
DMRC did not know the name of Jagli.
They
were calling ASI. They're sitting in Delhi and doing it without coming here and saying they can't.
See, now what has happened is, this is now the actually what happened is in February, as a, in the previous listing, what we saw approval. For GM October 2013 and submission by Government of Maharashtra for approval to Government of India in December 2013. So actually the first formal approval happened in December 2013. And after that... This was submission I am talking of. So submission was done in December 2013. And then in February 2014, actually, Mr. Sharad Pawar personally went to Kamal Nath, sat with him and then said, do something and give me some at least. Kamal Nath, their own government said that this report we cannot
approve.
This is meaning even after so many years that was not in a state of getting approved.
So surprisingly, the same government of the same state approved the Nagpur DMRC.
Yes, we are talking about Pune.
See, we have to always have a comparison. Why do you say
that? I have a comparison in my city. I am not interested in what happens in Nagpur because I don't have the time to go and study that. It's the job of the Nagpur people to see.
Aparna, the presentation is something.
What we are telling is that you see the conditions. So, Kamal Nath gave approval. But he called it in principle approval, so it's meaningless. In principle approval was given a long time back. In fact, the central government has a policy that every 20 lakh and above you can make metro. So that in principle approval was already there. It was just to satisfy Mr. Sharad Pawar that Kamal Nath said, okay, I'll give you approval. But actual letter which came had, these are only part of the conditions. There are a lot many conditions that this approval has to be is subject to these conditions. So these are some of the conditions which we are related to traffic. There are a lot of other conditions are there, like finance and all that. So I have not highlighted them. But the major conditions related to traffic are these. There should be an integration of various modes, improvement in city bus service. That central government is telling.
Yeah.
Then first and last mile connectivity or metro, it is not shown in that report. So actually why these conditions have come up? Because the details are not in the report. You understand that? If these conditions had already been fulfilled in the report, these conditions would not have come. So there is no mention about integrating of various modes. There is no mention of city bus service. There is no mention of first and last mile connectivity. There is no comprehensive mobility plan PMC has prepared in 2008. But they have not implemented it, they are just on paper just to satisfy the JNRM conditions to get the finance. So that is how that plan is there. Then single department at city level for transport issues. Then setting up urban transport fund, we are hearing, you must be all hearing there are urban transport fund, BUMTA, all this we are hearing for years, nothing is happening. advertisement policy, parking policy, nothing has happened. So they have put these conditions that you should have do this, all this. Then only, and one important condition, actually what we have been doing is that we were corresponding with PNC, then with Government of Maharashtra. Both of them did not reply to a single letter. Then we have started corresponding with central government. And we have written a lot of letters to Mr. Kamal Nath when he was then Secretary Sunil Krishna, and we got replies from them. And they had forwarded those letters to PMC, and PMC gave all these issues. And PMC gave the replies to this thing, central government. We are sitting in Pune, PMC is in Pune, we meet on different, for various other reasons, as part of our activities. But metro, they said, we will not talk about metro. So, I am sitting in Pune, I write to central government. Central government sends that letter to with my name and everything to PMC. PMC commissioner replies to central government, and then central government sends that PMC reply to me. So, that is the thing happening. So, to what extent PMC is so adamant and so this thing, we can see from that. So, actually then what happened is, 3 times this happened, then we wrote to the central government that PMC is not listening to you and it's meaningless, you just forwarding our letters to them and they replying and you forwarding their postmans. So, you put some condition on PMC that they will be made to talk to us and understand. So, surprisingly, in this in-principle approval letter, the last para, so we can say last but not the least, is that they have advised state government and PMC to rework the DPR. Rework the DPR, those are the wordings. Rework the DPR on a realistic basis. Those are the wording, exact wording in that I got the letter. And on a realistic basis, with adequate deliberation on issues raised by various stakeholders to ensure sustainability of the project. These are exact wordings of the letter written by UPA government to state government and the state. So that was in February. We are in now September. Corporation has still not done anything. They have chosen to totally ignore the advice. And not only ignore the advice, you will be surprised that they are misleading the central government. They have sent reply to all these points, and in the point against this point, what they have written is that this report has been approved by PMC GB general body, and whatever your comment, MOUD, Ministry of Urban Development comments, we have already taken care of with deliberation, and all issues have been addressed. So that is the absolutely utter lie and falsehood.
Yeah.
And we have written to central government that this is the falsehood and how they have said this. So that you can see the length to which PMC is going to protect this.
They are
just lying. They
have
issued
that. This is a fantastic. I would call it a fantastic nonsense. You have not talked even to us, and you are telling them all issues are in address. So, we have written to central government that please don't rely on PMC's reply, and we and a few of the other organizations we have sent just 3-4 days back, that you send your own representative to Pune now, because PMC is telling all falsehood. You send your representative and let him interact with us and see the ground reality.
This is the new government.
They are going to create infrastructure.
So other conditions,
one question here basically which I am just trying to figure out. The Government of India comments, the conditions are common across the board, irrespective whichever metro it is. Across the board, DMRC has prepared the proposals. So it is only Pune where DMRC has prepared and the Government of India has just put the conditions where they have not fulfilled it. But all the other 12 metros which the same DMRC has done it, has fulfilled the conditions.
Actually, there could be two issues.
Let me answer this. The point is this, that all these governments probably lie.
Huh?
And there are no citizen groups in these cities who are telling, who are bringing up.
Yes, sir, we are telling.
We are telling. We are telling.
So, you take a little bit. All of the ones are on the ground. Why only in India have a ground? Just think about it.
Forget that issue.
We cannot answer that question, why it has been done in that way. See, that was the condition. And then, on the actual DPR, they have sent their comments. And those comments run into several pages, various departments, Ministry of Railways, then Intelligence Bureau, then Planning Commission, then IUP, then lot of various departments of the central government have sent their comments on the DPR, and they are quite extensive. So that again shows that there are so many flaws, lacunae, deficiencies in that report. Otherwise, why should so many comments come? And that actually we are questioning. We are, the same thing, PMC or DMRC were the gods of metro, then why are so much this thing? We have written to the corporation. You explain to us why the delay has happened. So delay has not only happened in terms, you see, for your information, this metro, as per the DMRC plan, was supposed to be commissioned this year in March 14. So March 14, both these corridors should have been commissioned. We are now in 14, it has not also been approved, and now the revised date is 2021. So 7 years ahead. So these 7 years ahead is going to have two impacts. One is, suppose, assuming even the believing PMC that okay, this is a solution to Pune's traffic problems. In 7 years, what would happen to that traffic problem? Because your metro is now getting delayed by 7 years. And then secondly, about 50% price rise has happened. Who's going to bear it? Citizens. It's public money. So who is responsible for this? Why it was delayed from 2009 to 2014 and now still 2020?
I think the answer is because the citizens of Pune are too inquisitive, and the citizens in other 14 metro cities have just accepted it blindly and they have gone further for it, maybe.
Yeah, so this is the some of the points on which they have said comments. They have said, we were telling them from day one that you should have, as I said, there's a hierarchy of modes, and you should have cost-benefit analysis as to which mode you should accept. So the same points now, the Government of India is telling them, where is your alternatives analysis? For other modes of mass transit like BRT, light rail, etc., before arriving at the decision of metro, they are not done in analysis, and we are asking them, you should do it. They are not done, so they are asking. And this point, I will tell you a very, another blatant lie that PMC has told this central government is that in reply to this point, they have written that BRT is not practical,
not feasible,
on this,
not feasible.
Practical on this corridors. See, they have got this approved from the central government itself. They have taken 900 crores of rupees of funds. They have entire corridors in the metro, BRT plan approved, funds taken, spent, and they are telling the same central government that BRT is not practical in this corridor.
Where are the 1100 crores? That's why they are
asking. So that is the extent, I am telling you how you can believe PMC in any way. So funding pattern, cost escalation, they are not considered properly. Land requirement has not been considered. Land acquisition cost has not been considered. And they are telling you that extra cost that SP will bear. How can the SP will bear? The central government is telling them this is the land acquisition law. Have you considered all the compensation that needs to be given? So no, what they are saying is 2000 vehicle law, it has recently come. We have not considered that, but whatever is the implication, the SP will bear. Have you considered escalation for land cost? Not considered. So land, if we are going to apply after 4 years, they are putting the prices of January 2013 only for that. So they say, no, escalation factor we are not considered, but we will, mechanism we will bear. So these are the frequent answers that are being given, and so this shows how serious it is and how the issues are going to create more problems when the execution starts, if it ever starts. So then disaster management, there was no chapter on that. So you are asking about DMRC, there is no disaster management, no security measures, no cyber security, nothing was there. They said you put a chapter of that. Why you have not put it? So that disaster management was there. Then they have asked us, you have chosen a particular coach of 2.59 meters width. Why you have not chosen 3.2 meters, which is a bigger coach running on the same rails? That would have carried more passengers.
Because DMRC is using broad gauge.
No, but no. Same standard gauge, same rails, why you have chosen 2.9? Where is your analysis for that?
You are only manufactured in India.
Standard gauge was not manufactured in India.
They have not said so. We are asking them.
This is not the case. Actually, 3.2 meters is also allowed. We are talking of standard gauge only. Then what is the basis for selection of standard gauge? That also central government has asked.
Yeah, we should go for broad gauge.
So then they have asked about the low ridership. So low ridership is there, headway is 10 minutes, 12 minutes, this is a very high headway time for metro. Then they are saying that if you consider the ridership, they are saying whatever metro you have chosen, 2.9 meter width and all, that itself is oversized. That meaning by corollary it shows that the ridership is so low that they have chosen the lowest the metro design. That also is all provision, that sort of a comment has come because the ridership is very low.
No, but Delhi metro ridership is very good.
Delhi is Delhi has a big network. See, this is again few basic points about elevated versus underground. So actually, most of the drawbacks problems are not covered. Entire thing only the highlights are there. With elevated metro, do not exist in case of underground metro. And expected life of elevated metro is much less than underground metro. That is one thing due to above ground steel and concrete structures. Then safety level is less than underground metro. Then elevated metro stations not possible at desired locations with elevated metro. While example within railway station with direct access possible with underground metro. Interconnectivity of elevated metro route with other routes cannot be done. You cannot have interconnectivity between two elevated routes. But interconnectivity is possible with underground because you can have under the levels. We can have multiple levels. 3, 4, 5 levels. Metros have been built in the world.
Yeah.
So there is no limit. So you can just walk down and go to the other. So that is not possible with elevated metros. Then basic capital cost as we were talking is definitely high, but you have to consider certain factors are saving due to some reasons such as shorter route length. So route length, as she said, as the crow flies, so route length drastically reduces and it is not necessary to follow the road alignment. Then as Mr. Rao was saying, reduction in cost if broad gauge is option is chosen as claimed by
Central. No land acquisition if you are underground.
Pardon?
No land acquisition if you are
underground. Yeah, no. That all has been covered under this thing. These are additional points. Whatever the, that's why I said most of the drawback problems which you have discussed are already not, do not exist in metro. And then real cost of elevated metro. I just put a slide here just to impress upon you what is the real cost of elevated metro. So direct cost of underground metro is no doubt higher than elevated metro. But cost per year of life. You see the life of an elevated metro is say 25 years and life of an underground metro is maybe
100 years.
Except the rolling stock maintenance, it can be unlimited. 1869 I think the metro was commissioned, it's still working.
So, 20 years ago.
Yeah, so it is almost unlimited, but even if you take 100 years, it is 4 times. So what we are saying is you consider the cost per year of life, don't consider as a just as a lump sum amount. And second is cost of the impacts. What we talked of was the impacts of the elevated metro on the people of the city and the city. These are everything, hardships, land acquisition, increased traffic congestion, tree cutting. This has a value. This has tremendous value. So that has to be added to the elevated metro cost. You cannot only take what you are spending. So this has, so all such costs need to be factored in the cost for elevated metro to know its real cost for the city. So that has not been done, obviously. Now, she is talking about 4 acres. What is happening is, now we talked about low ridership. So they said, okay, ridership is low. So what DMRC says is, when on both sides you give a higher acreage, densification is very,
so the more
very attractive and very lovable word that they
use. Is this city plan undertaken in other cities? Like
now they say only in Nagpur it has been done, that is what we hear.
Have they implemented it?
No, no, Nagpur is just sanctioned.
I don't think any city will tolerate it. Nagpur
is keeping. No, maybe this is
an exception. First time it has appeared in Nagpur metro, that is, up till now it was nowhere. The first time it has appeared in Nagpur, that is what we have come to know, but we have not seen the Nagpur metro. But see, basic reason they have given are two for this. Meaning, one they have given, but corporation is stressing on the second reason. They say to increase ridership of metro. So basically this proves that metro ridership is not enough. Of course that is already there in their